Blackstone Audio presents Cold Storage Alaska by John Straley. This book is read by Stephen R. Thorne. Chapter 1. Annabelle had put the tea kettle on just moments ago. Now it was whistling, yet she didn't get up to attend to it. Recently, the past had become a hallucination, constantly intruding into the present moment, so she wasn't certain what really needed doing. She had been thinking about Franklin Roosevelt, the grinning man with the cigarette holder, who was never photographed in his frailty. But now it was early spring in the last year of Bill Clinton's presidency, and all the news was about the president's failings. Flawed men kept ruling the world, and the radio in the corner with the long antenna squealed on and on about it. Not that the news mattered much to Annabelle now. It was raining hard, and all of the events of her life, past, present, and possibly future, were taking on the quality of a slightly malevolent screwball comedy. She sat in her chair looking out the window. She had been distracted by so many things lately, presidents, family members, and lost animals all swirling around her. The glass on the door rattled, and she looked up, expecting to see her uncle, Slippery Wilson, walk in, slapping his wet leather gloves against his pants, even though Slippery Wilson had been dead for more than 3 decades. She found herself listening for crying from the crib, even though both her boys were grown men. The younger one, Miles, was down at the senior center cooking dinner, and Clive was getting out of prison. "Never matter," Annabelle said aloud to herself. She got up and turned off the radio in the corner. Throughout the afternoon, she had been trying to remember the joke she had heard the day before. It was good, she remembered, and she thought that it would have been good to tell Miles. But the joke eluded her in its detail. Out her window, the hillside fell away to the inlet. Alder trees grew quickly on the disturbed ground where the boys had built her house. A gust of wind came, and she thought she saw some darting color. A flash of yellow, she couldn't be sure, but it seemed like a matchhead exploding, yellow with red sparks flaring in the trees. She slid her glasses up her nose and was almost certain that she saw the bird fluttering up and away. "Buddy," she said aloud, as the kettle boiled over and doused the flame. On that same day in April 2000, Clive McCahon, Annabelle's oldest son, was released from prison. He was thinking about his plan to get home. He had hated living in Alaska as a kid. His father had assumed he would become a fisherman. His mother had assumed that no matter how he made his living, it would be made right there in cold storage. Only his grandma Ellie had told him not to listen and to dream his own dreams. Having grown up on an island on the North Pacific, Clive had longed for the Great American Highway. He dreamed of cars and deserts and long, straight roads. Ellie had always given him books about cars for every birthday and Christmas. Cars and guitars, he dreamed of. Bands he heard on the radio and beautiful girls who didn't know everything about him. Ellie had understood his itch to move on. Only she seemed to understand that living in cold storage Alaska was like being born into a small maze where everyone constantly bumped into one another. As soon as his father died in the Thanksgiving Day storm, Clive had left. He had flown north to Haines, bought a car without ever owning a license, without ever learning to drive, and took off. He was 15. Ellie's ashes had been scattered at sea and his father's body had never been found, so he didn't consider that he had anything holding him to his cloistered island town. Clive was 35 now. It was early April, and the clouds were clearing away after a morning rain. The air was so clean it almost burned his lungs. Clive had served 7 out of his 10-year sentence in McNeil Island Penitentiary, and he was wearing his old court clothes, a dark blue suit his mother had bought him on one of his few visits home as an adult, now far too tight in his shoulders and upper arms. Feeling the sun cut through the trees, he set his cardboard box on the ground, slipped off the coat, folded it neatly, and placed it on top of the box. He had called ahead to order a cab. There were only a few people getting off the prison boat, mostly staff members carrying lunch boxes and rain gear. There was one other inmate, a skinny white kid with red hair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.